Well, good morning. Welcome to Fellowship Baptist Church, Chetwynd, B.C. Pastor Bill Evans, and glad to welcome you in the name of the Lord to our worship service. We put together a full service of songs and whatever, and understand that a computer at home, you can move along that program however you wish. And so we're able to do that, and we're glad to welcome you and each one here this morning. So we want to start off with some kids' songs, as we always do, and what's this guy? The Carter and Company. We're choosing this one. Daniel was a man of prayer. Daily he prayed three times. And I was reading an article about that this week. And they said the reason why he ended up in jail was because of the envy of others. And that's an interesting word there for sure. Daniel was a man of prayer. Daily he prayed three times, even when they had him cast in the den of lions. It's a wonderful story.
Daniel was a man of prayer. Daily he prayed three times, even when they had him cast in a den of lions. Even then in the den, fear could not alarm him. God had shut the lion's mouth, so they could not harm him.
Okay, only a boy named David. Only a little sling.
Only a boy named David, only a little sling. Only a boy named David, but he could pray and sing. Only a boy named David, only a rippling brook. Only a boy named David, but five little stones he took. And one little stone went in the sling, and the sling went round and round. And one little stone went in the sling, and the sling went round and round. And around and around and around and around.
And then that was the end of Mr. Goliath. Okay, who got older this week? Somebody did, I heard. Ross did? Okay, what was your, you're December. Okay. Anybody else have a birthday this week? One of the Cram kids had a birthday Friday, was it, or is it today?
Louise is today.
Louise Knox is today, too? Louise Knox, if you run into her, you end up in jail, go in the jail door, she answers the door. And how can I help you? When I go to the jail, I go in the back door. And it's not, how can I help you? I know I can help you. Someone says, it's not my fault. I said, seems to me it's never your fault. Anyhow, but it wasn't any of you that I see here. Anyhow, okay. All right, is your birthday? No, no birthdays? Well, we're going to sing happy birthday to folks at home that we might miss and whatever. Here we go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Only one will not do. Born again through salvation. How many have you?
Born in the family of God. Born into our own parents' family. That gets us here. And then we have a responsibility before we die to be born in the family of God, with relationship in Jesus. So that's what our second verse is about. Thank you. Well, the worship team's going to come now. They've been practicing, and Karen's got the cello this morning with a microphone, so you're going to be able to really hear it rather than just see it. So pay attention. And she's professional. Yeah, sure.
Good morning, everybody, and just welcome here. Please stand with us as we worship. God of Wonders is the song. The heavens are take a moment to greet someone, welcome them here. Have a seat.
Okay, honestly, I can't hear you guys, so turn it up a little, please. No. Sorry, sometimes I say too much, right, Bill?
Bring clear, I find my rest.
room for a runaround preacher. Well, thank you, and again, welcome. You're tuning in later with us here. We're expecting to be on the radio, but we either are or we aren't. Those are options. I said the Daily Bread for September is at the back. If you need those, help yourself. We were just talking about doing a little bit different program for our offering, and because people coming in from home and whatever like this, there's no sense them having that dead air time while you're passing the plate around. So if you can just use the baskets at the back, and I'm hearing that people are using most of the checks and online and doing all those different things anyhow, so the offering baskets are not being that greatly utilized. But anyhow, if you remember to do that. Another thing is at the back there's some little cards, papers. If you want to, if you don't believe you're on our church list, we're making a new one, fixing it, and getting rid of people that have moved on long ago and whatever. If you want to be on there, put your name and last name and your first name, and then your email address if you want, your phone number, which is your cell or whatever. If you have a house and you want your both numbers there, put them there. And so just on there. So most of you are on there. If you're new, you want to be on there. If you got an email address you didn't have before, then we're going to upgrade that. And so the list will be have some removed and some new ones added on there. So thanks for that attention to it. And just say, put it in the envelope for the offering or whatever you want to do if you need to do that. Okay, one other thing. Board had a meeting yesterday, and here it comes, thank you. And so we're going to call for a quarterly business meeting. We need to have one. August is when we normally do. August 8th, which is... two Sundays from now. Next Sunday is August 1st, and we'll have communion. And then after that, well, August 8th. And we sat down with a young man that preached here last week, and all the reports that I heard, everybody was impressed enough. We talked with him, and we want to make a recommendation to the church that we hire him as a youth pastor. So that's what that meeting will be entailing, and other business if we have any at that time. So just be mindful of that, and it's whatever. See what they pray about it and see what the will of the Lord is for that situation. And Josh is the young fella in question here. We had a good time. We believe he's got a good heart. Normally, in these situations, you find somebody wherever around and can bring him in, look at him. Josh has been around our church for 5 years, and we've seen him grow and do whatever like that, and that's been good. And all the reports we got, the people that work with the youth and whatever, John Mann recommended him. Brady recommends him. These are guys that are working with the youth now. And they said, so what are we, dumb? Take a look at it and see what, unless something really comes up, something strange that was ever, then that would be our business meeting. So we don't all weigh it, to slay it, whatever, but pray and ask. And if God says to you, vote no, then vote no. But that's our thinking for that date, August the 8th. Thank you. Okay. The offering information is there, baptist@priest.ca. And the prayer chain, gets pretty good use, that prayer chain. Jana's boy was on the prayer chain this week, fell off a balcony and fractured a couple of ribs and then a couple of vertebrae, 6 and 8, did you say? 6 and 8. And so continue to pray for him. He's eating and expecting to be out of the hospital here in with 10 days or so. So just pray for his full recovery, if you would. Okay, anything else particular there? All right, okay. Let's carry on with our first hymn, Majesty. And the other day at Ashley's wedding, I'm talking to the groom about something quickly, and all of a sudden she's standing in front of us. I didn't even get to say everybody rise. But as we rise for brides and grooms, let's rise and sing Majesty as we worship Jesus and the Lord in our service this morning.
Worship His Majesty, Jesus who died.
God, we bless you for the majesty and the glory of your name, a name that you chose as you're the great Jehovah, the self-existent God. You said, I want to give a name that is going to be above every name. And at that name, every knee shall bow and confess that he is Lord to your glory. And that's that precious name of Jesus. We thank you this morning. We come in his name to worship you. We come through your name, his name, and through his grace. And in his name, we find salvation. We find cleansing for our sin. We find help in our day. He prays for us in our struggles. We've sang about facing temptations and whatever. And with Peter, he said, the devil's desired to have you, to sift you like wheat, but I have prayed for you. And this is the wonder of the one of whom we sing and worship you through this morning, Jesus Christ our Lord. So we bless you, and we ask God that by your great Spirit, that third person of the Trinity, you would come down among us, and you would bow the heavens and come down and tailor to us a blessing here that only you can give, and then send us out rejoicing in the goodness of our God and into the ministry that lies before us in a community here full of many people lost and perishing and groping in darkness, trying to find light and life. We thank you, Father, for Camp Sagatawa folk being with us this morning. We pray your blessing on that ministry, that they'll be encouraged and that they'll have souls for their hire, and your mercy will attend and bless in mighty ways. So give them strength and help and meet all the needs, and bless the campers that are going there today, and give them a good time, O God, by your Spirit, we pray. Father, we pray for those who are laid aside on beds of illness, those who are weak physically, and Bob Nicholson, that you make his body strong. We pray for Bobby, that she be strengthened and encouraged. Hold her close and bless her, O God, is our prayer. And for others, we do pray for John's boy, that he might continue to be made strong and raised up to health and strength. And we pray for John Stockman's sister, that she might come out of her coma from COVID and be raised up to health and strength, O God. Hear our prayer. So we'll leave these matters in your hands, but expect that, God, your Spirit would attend to meet with us in this hour, that we would rejoice in your goodness and go out rejoicing in your care and your blessing and challenge from your word for the week that's ahead. So receive our thanks and ask your blessing in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Be seated, please. We had a fun time the other night up at Binky's house celebrating a year late, but Miss Cher Amelia, she had a celebration of her graduation from high school last year, and now she's since then got a year of university done. So it was quite a good time. And one of the funny ones was that she graduated from a class of one, so she got to be the valedictorian. And she says, Wellington graduated, and he was the valedictorian. And so I'm graduating, and I'm the valedictorian. So she looks at her younger brother and says, no pressure. So, and Levi is the quieter of the bunch, I think, that anyhow, so he, in a couple of years, we'll see his graduation, his valedictorian address. It was quite fun. We had a good time. So we pray God's blessing on Amelia. And another thing that was said was Ramsey sent, his boss said, send me a couple of your newbies down there. I got some training. I want them to learn in Tumbler Ridge. So we went up there. He sent Amelia and Andrew and went up there. And at the end of the day, he phoned Ramsey. He said, where'd you get these two kids? They're just naturals. So smart and whatever. That's God's blessing on lives of kids that love the Lord. So that is just wonderful to see. All right, let's sing another song. And this one is called, we haven't sang this in a while, New Name and Glory. And I hope yours is there. And you go a second. Pauline's trying to find it there. 622, I think, is it? All right, here we go. I once was a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word, kept his word. There's a new name, it's written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner. Hallelujah, there's a sign written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown.
heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home, hallelujah. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. Sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. In the book is written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know, by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. Sing the story, a sinner has come home, hallelujah. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
That's good, eh? That's refreshing. Good song, good singing. Thank you for that. Well, really, I don't have anything planned except the message next. And we'll take down some prayer and praise items if people have others to add. Anything particular to add to those prayer requests we've had? Ross? Okay. Pray for a guy named Brian. Ross has been with cancer. There's lots of cancer stuff happening and whatever around there. So, yeah. And Bob in hospital trying to get strong. Wants to be around for that wedding on the end of August. And pray for me this week, Wednesday. I got those 2 14-minute messages we put on television and whatever. Does anybody watch Chet TV? Are they on there? I don't watch Chet TV. So here they're there. We tape them up and put them there. So we often just use messages from here. The pastors were, well, that's a lot of extra work. And somebody said, well, we just use the stuff you preach in your pulpit. So I've been doing some of that and adding stuff too and whatever. So just pray for those that they go well, though. Anything else? Camp Sagatawa this week? What's happening this week? Okay. Good. Monday after lunch, okay? All right. More takers? Pray for Camp Sagatawa. Ed, the valley's doing good? Yeah, okay. Usual unspoken, that's good. All right. And I had a request for a young person that doing a lot of drinking. And I asked last week, how's this doing? I said, he's quit drinking at that point, so that was good. And then I find out that he's in the hospital. So talking to his mom this week, and how's he doing? He's always in the hospital. So if it's going to help him get over his alcoholism and whatever, that's good. So pray for those people. There's people out there hurting, and the devil tells them and the bottle tells them when to take part, and they don't have that choice really in themselves except run, and they don't have the ability to run very often. So as the guy said in jail tonight, it's not my fault. And that's the devil's lie in her ear. It is your fault, and you need to face up and run and whatever. So it's strange, but anywho. Okay, let's sing another song. And that was the end of the prayer request? Good, all right. Let's do another one. Peace be still. I had to phone Pauline and give her heads up on this one. Master, the billows are raging. The tempest is raging. The billows are tossing high. That's waves in the sea. The sky is overshadowed with blackness. No shelter or help is nigh. Do you not care that we perish? That's a rhetorical question in our Christian faith. Let's stand again as we sing.
Master, the tempest is raging. The billows are tossing high. The sky is o'ershadowed with blackness. No shelter or help is nigh. Carest thou not that we perish? How can you lie asleep? When each moment so madly is threatening, a grave in the angry deep. The winds and the waves shall obey my will. Peace. froth of the storm-tossed sea, or demons, or men, or whatever it be. No water can swallow that ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace be still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace, peace be still. Master, with anguish of spirit, I bow in my grief today. The depths of my sad heart are troubled. Awaken and save, I pray. Torrents of sin and of anguish weep o'er my sinking soul. And I perish, dear Master. Oh, hasten and take control. The winds and the waves shall obey my will. Peace be still. Whether the wrath of the storm-tossed sea, or demons, or men, or whatever it be, no water can swallow that ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace be still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace, peace be still. Master, the terror is over, the elements sweetly rest. Earth's sun and the calm lake is mirrored, and heaven's within my breast. Linger, O blessed Redeemer, leave me alone no more. And at last I shall make the blessed harbor and rest on the peaceful shore. The winds and the waves shall obey my will. Peace be still. Whether the wrath of the storm-tossed sea, or demons, or men, or whatever it be, the water can swallow that ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace be still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace, peace be still.
Be seated, please. Thank you. That's so fun to be able to sing all the songs in the hymn book now and make you stand up so you don't even have to worry about banging your head on the roof of your car. That was kind of hard for a while, to all the years of doing that and then not have you do that and what. So we live in a day in which, if you're paying attention to the news, I find there's people that, like my son, oftentimes, he didn't know about the thing in Florida, that building falling down for 2 weeks after the fact. I said, that thing fell down in Florida. He said, what? Do you not listen to the news? Nope. Okay. Well, that's different. Well, in case you haven't been listening to the news, there's a whole bunch of stuff happening out in the world. I mean, the world's getting crazier, and it might be the end. It can be. There's going to be the birth pangs and towards Jesus' return and all that. The devil. My big thing with that whole program is that somewhere the devil's got to start turning up the heat on the church, and having the radio buzz out just before the service is not much of an issue with the devil, all right? But there's things happening, and for which we as people of God and churches, whatever, so we see churches being burned. And that's happening out there, and whatever, church being destroyed. Vancouver, there's one, and other ones around being burned down. And people with social issues and taking it out on that. But we've seen other situations where strange things have happened around churches and whatever. So the idea is, I want to consider this thought about a fortified church, a fortified church. What would you fortify a church with? Niacinamide? Or would you use fortified with vitamin D or whatever? That's what they put on your cereal box, right? No, the fortification of the church is, I thought it was kind of a strange discussion, but I got some words that I want us to consider this morning about them. And so I believe that if we can consider some truths about fortifying the church and find out what the word says, what the scriptures say about a church being fortified. So let's try to answer that question this morning if we can together. Let's ask God's help as we do. Father, we thank you. Your word is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path, and good for instruction, reproof, and instruction in righteousness. conviction and all those things. So we ask as we open it up this morning, your spirit would attend to help my expressions, to help the listening ears here and abroad, to, Father, help people to grasp the importance of having and being part of the fortified church of Jesus Christ. So receive our thanks and bless us in this time in Jesus' name. Amen. The first thing we want to consider is always mindset. And if you haven't got this verse in your head, I'll hound on you until you get it. And know that when you see disastrous things happen, this is the verse that should come to your mind, Jeremiah 17 and verse 9. It says, "The heart is more deceitful than all else and desperately sick. Who can understand it?" And when you see something go weird in the world, why did that happen? Because this is the what God says about the heart of people. I heard about a bridge that was in a new bridge was built, and before they used it, it fell down. And so the leader of the area called the priests together, the pastors together, and said, "We want to have a prayer for this bridge." Well, it fell down. What's there to pray? There's things that happen out there. But it goes back to this verse: the heart is more deceitful than desperately wicked. Who can understand this stuff? And so that's an important verse to have in your mind. But we want to go on from there down to Matthew chapter 16. And here we have a very famous story, with Jesus talking. And so the first thing we want, the church is fortified with the truth about the lost. The truth about the lost, what's that got to do with a fortified church? Well, first off, if there were no lost, there would be no need for church. Right? So the church is what it is because there's lost people in the world. And the church needs to be fortified because there's lost people in the world. So Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi. He was asking his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" Now, Son of Man is a messianic term in the Jewish mind, whatever. He says, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And that's the first question. That's an important thing for us as a church to understand is, what does the world understand about the Son of Man, Jesus? What do they understand about Jesus? Well, generally, he's like a swear word, at most cases, at best, with lots of people, and whatever. And if he's tied to God, well, he's tied to the great, he's an alpha for the great Santa Claus God. And that's what people think about Jesus and God. But the question, my glasses on the floor making it shine like a mouse running around on there, I just about left. Be still my heart. I don't do mice at home. I don't do mice, okay? I put these glasses on so I can read. The question is, and this, beloved, is what the church has to have, is who do we say Jesus is? In verse 14, we find their answer to this question, what the world says about who the Son of Man is, and we have it there, verse 14. And it says, verse 14 says, well, they say John the Baptist. Or it says, here he is, John the Baptist. Or maybe it's Elijah, or maybe he's Jeremiah, or just one of the prophets. He's come down, and he's come alive, and whatever, he's in there doing this work for God. Maybe it's one of these. But you see what the problem is? That's where the world goes. They end up anywhere but where the right answer is, and the right answer is Jesus. Is it what's going to come up in this story? You know the story. And they said, so some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and whatever. But their religious blindness brings them to everything but the right answer. Everything but the right answer. And truth is a standard. Truth is truth. And two and two is four all the time, all countries in the world. I asked my Oriental friend who lived at my house one time. I said, so how many numbers do you have in China? They got 500 letters. I said, how many numbers do you guys have? She looked at me like, you got to mess with these people's brains. Come on. I said, how many numbers you got? She looked at me. Yeah, we got 10. So religious blindness, everything but the real answer, the right answer in Jesus Christ. And then, beloved, with that story there of the truth about the lost, where's the greatest issue with the truth about the lost? It's found in Luke 19, verse 10. For the Son of Man, same one. Who do people say the Son of Man is? Jesus, I'll tell you who he is. He's one who came to seek and to save that which was lost. That which has been lost in Adam, that which has been lost in the world, that's been lost by people and whatever. And church-wise, if we're careful, and people go out and whatever, there's the 90 and 9, and they go, he leaves all those, and he goes and finds that one that's lost. And those that are hurting and whatever, try to find those. But the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. And that's the first thing about a fortified church, is their truth about the lost. They have to understand what it is. And then the next point is the truth about the church's challenge. The truth about the church's challenge. Verse 15, we have here, it says, he said to them, and but, And this but word, there's a couple of words in Greek, and I preached on that one time. There's one word is emphatic about emphasis, and the other word is just in comparison. And the comparison comes up in this passage here, whatever. There's four times it says emphatic, emphasis. So he said to them with emphasis, "Who do you say that I am?" With emphasis, who do you say that I am? See, that's the big question of the people of God, is who do we say Jesus is? And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And this is not the I am as in Ego Eimi, where he claims the name. It's just, who do you say that I be? Who do you say that I be? The Greek word is just, who do you say that I be? The Son of Man, who do you say that I be? So that's the question for the church, is to understand the challenge. Is the emphasis, and who do we say? And it says, do we know it? And then do we say it? To know it and to say it are two different things. Lots of people know the gospel and know all things about whatever like this and whatever. We have to share the gospel and let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say what you know about God. I like that statement, make sure you are living it. If your words don't match your actions, shut your mouth. If your actions are all terrible and all those things, then if they don't match, then be quiet. Let me tell you about Jesus, and then live like the devil. And it's dangerous ground. But we have to know and say, and the know idea is experientially know this. Okay, if you're just a newborn Christian, you can tell people you come to know Jesus and whatever. You can put that all out there. That's good. Have you experienced it much? No. Well, we go through some trials, and when you find out, that becomes the experiential relationship with Jesus. When there have been trials, and then you find that he helped you through. The master, the tempest is raging. Do you not care that we perish? And guess what? He says, peace be still. Yes, I do care. Yes, I do care. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Is the challenge of the church. Make sure we say that right and understand it and put it right. The next thing is that the truth that is emphatically written is this what we have this famous passage is all about. The truth is emphatically written, and here it is in verse 16. It says, Simon Peter answered. And the Greek has one word for all these things here except for the of. The of is tied into the Greek verb that's there. And he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter said that. Who's this Peter guy? You know Peter. He's that attention deficit guy. I relate to Peter. Some attention deficit jump in there. Sometimes speak before you should or whatever. But in this case here, he did the right thing. He's been rebuked. Remember, get behind me, Satan. Peter's mouth talking away. Oh, that can't happen. You can't die on a cross. Whatever. Get behind me, Satan. But here, Simon Peter answers, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And he's the leader of the apostles at this point, and he's given this statement here. But, beloved, it's written emphatically that this here, Simon Peter answered, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. You know what's important? When the apostle Paul later on, he'll rebuke Peter or whatever, but Paul was given and was prepared for this job. But in 2 Timothy verse 3, we have the statement here. All scripture is inspired by God. That word inspired, beloved, is an important word. It means God breathed. God breathed them words out. God breathed into Paul the words that he wanted. And so, when you get a chance to share the gospel with some, if you're waiting on the Lord, you can have a whole rote thing, whatever, like this. But the question might throw that off a bit, and God will help you to say the very words that are important. Well, when it comes to Scripture, God actually breathed and inspired and whatever. The very words we think of Scripture, each one, whether it's in Christ or by Christ or whatever, those things are all inspired of God. And then so he says, this is inspired by God. God breathed, and it's profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and training in righteousness. The Word of God is those things. And so we have that there, that Paul makes this statement that Peter has already made, that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And that's so important. The truth that is written emphatically there. Let's go to the next point. this truth about Christ blesses our stance. Is that we take this stance, and churches say, "Well, how come I had this statement made of a church, and it's just full of old people, and nobody comes?" And I know the background of that denomination situation. And the Word of God, well, might be the Word of God if you want. If you stand for nothing, guess what? You fall for everything. And so here, this guy says, there's a big church in this town, and it's empty. Few old people go there. Why? Because if you don't preach that the Bible is the Word of God that changes lives, shut the doors. Shut the doors. All scriptures inspired by God is profitable. And so Peter makes this statement. And so Jesus says to him, Peter, you are blessed for this statement you made. And so Jesus said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And that's the important part. Jesus said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because you've got this, but flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. This wasn't you learning in Sabbath school or so whatever school you went to these things. This has not been that. This has been revealed to you by my Father in heaven. It's an interesting verse. It ties in and makes this statement. Proverbs 28:18 is right there. He who walks blamelessly will be delivered. I give you 28:18. Anyhow, there's a verse there that says, without no revelation, the people are unrestrained. I must have given you the wrong reference there. It looks like 27, but anyhow, without revelation, the people are unrestrained. And then 1 Samuel 2:3 and verse 1, I give you that one. You got it right. It says, now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord before Eli, and the word from the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were infrequent. And how this ties in here is, Peter, lots of stuff hasn't been happening. But God says, flesh and blood's not revealed this to you, Peter, but my Father in heaven. And in those statements that were made, when you see that, and people look, well, revelation from God. Somebody stands up, I got a revelation from God. Well, first off, what's our question? Is it in line with the book? Is it in line with the book? If it's not in line with the book, that makes you a false prophet. Don't expect what they say to happen. And if it doesn't happen, where do you send the rocks? That's what he says. And so the boy Samuel was ministering, and there was a word from the Lord was rare in those days, and whatever. And that was an Old Testament situation. We're coming to the New Testament, and God reveals to Peter this message. You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And God blesses Peter for his stance. The people without vision run restrained. The rest of the verse says, but those who follow the law are happy. They find happiness in the law, the Word of God. Don't worry about running around, being unrestrained because I got no vision from God. Well, whatever, I'll make up stuff. People do that. They make up stuff. And they add it to religious activity. Let's do this and do this and do this. I just challenge people, why does your religion do that? I don't know. I just did it for years. Well, it's interesting. If it don't make any sense, I say, where's it say in the Bible? You can't do that. And I get that about my food eating habits of tomato and peanut butter on or something. It doesn't say in the Bible you can't put tomato and peanut butter together. And they say if they have to live together down here, why can't they hold hands on the way down? Like, I don't understand. Why do people get upset with my eating habits? Ashley said that. Pastor Bill, that's just gross, whatever. So, well, entitled to your opinion, but I like it. So, whatever. There's things like shrimp. Don't put them in my mouth. If it don't say in the Bible, and it does say in the Bible, don't eat shrimp in the Old Testament. So be careful of that. All right. So here we have, beloved, truthfully, he blesses Peter for this situation, and he blesses him. When we take a stand on what is right with the Word of God, when we take a stand, that's statesmanship. Where's the best example of statesmanship in the Bible? Mordecai. Esther chapter 10. He did what was best for all the people. That's statesmanship. And so that's what we're challenged to be as people of God. And so God will bless us. We take our stand, and our stand is understanding what the things of God are. That he says, Peter, this has not been given to you by just whatever. My Father has revealed it to you. And blessed are you, Peter, for that. And that blessing upon Peter, some say Peter became the first of the Catholic leaders of the Catholic Church. Say, well, you're entitled to that opinion. He was there, and he was active in this situation. But anyhow, he was definitely the head leader of the apostles at that time. So he says, you're going to be the first in the story, Peter. And he is, and he passes off to Paul the work. I'll go to the Jews, and you go to the Gentiles. And he passed off the power and whatever to work with the Gentiles to Paul. But he was the leader of the church of Jerusalem with the apostles for years. Blessed are you. Can we go back to that verse, please? Last one in Matthew there, please. So blessed are you, Simon Barjona, because flesh and blood did not reveal this, but my Father. And so you're blessed, Simon. And so let's go on to the next part here. Here's the most fortifying truth I want you to take away. If you take nothing else out of this message today, take this truth here found in verse 18. And then Jesus says, I also say to you that you're Peter. And that's where that idea that you're Peter, you're going to be the head guy and the leader of this part, whatever. And upon this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not overpower it, stand against it. I say to you, you're Peter. You're Petra. Petro. Petra is the word. Not Petra. Petra comes onto the other rock is the word Petra. You're Petros. You're the important article. You're the subject of this discussion here. You're Peter. You're the guy out front. You're going to have the responsibility to lead this out. But he says, and upon this rock I'm going to build my church. This is the rock, and the Catholic friends take Peter as being the foundation of the Catholic Church. Said, well, I don't think that's a proper interpretation, because he says later, the apostles and prophets, and of course, as Peter is part of the apostleship, whatever, become that foundation of it. But he says, I'm going to build my church. And the building of the church was upon what? The statement that he made. The church is nothing if there's nothing to stand. And the cornerstone of the evangelical church is that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. He's the Son of the living God. If we understand that he's the Son of the living God, it's about we worship the Son of the living God. What's it mean when you're the Son of the living God? John 5:18 says they wanted to crucify Jesus because he called himself the Son of God, doing what? Making himself equal to God. You boys, your name. Your dad's name is in the offing here. Call yourself the son of somebody in Jewish mentality that made you equal with that person. He called himself the Son of God, making himself equal with God. And so the most important fortifying thing is, he says, you're Peter, but on this I'm going to build my church. And this, it's we think it's a statement. It's more the statement than Peter and whatever. The apostleship, yes, but this statement about Christ. Because in here it says, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it. I read an interesting article in preparation for this about this word Hades. You know my picking on that word experiential knowledge? One word is experience. The lady says, come and experience a man who told me everything I ever did in John 4. That's the same word as Hades here with a negative particle on the front. That blew me away. Hades is the unknown, unseen. It's translated from the Old Testament. Sheol in the Hebrew was the place of the departed. You were just gone. We don't know where you are. We just know you're gone. You're not here. We don't see you. You're gone. Okay? And this is taken off of that from the Jewish saying. It says, and the gates of Hades, the departed unseen, will not overpower this here. Death and destruction is not going to override with the work in the Church of Christ, what he's doing. And that's important, beloved, when we wrestle with the issue of dying for our Christian faith. If they kill you, so what if you know Jesus? You're gone to glory. Absent from the body, present with the Lord, is the scripture says. So that's interesting. He says here, the gates of Hades will not overpower it. We have a reference in Acts chapter 27. Okay, you will not, here it is, 2:27. It says, you will not abandon my soul to Hades. Important that it's Hades, the place of Sheol out of sight. Why? Because the other place, he says, why? Well, my beloved cannot see destruction. If he's in Gehenna, that's the burning pit over the wall of Jerusalem in the valley of Gehenna. We've talked about that. And he wasn't in Gehenna. He was in Hades, the place that he departed unseen. Because you will not abandon my soul to Hades, the place that departed, and leave it there, nor allow your Holy One to undergo decay. And that would be Gehenna with the destruction of the fire. You're not going to allow that there. And he says, you'll not abandon my soul to just being left out of sight. Why? Because Jesus is going to rise from the dead. And, of course, that's part of the program, right? The most fortifying statement. I will build my church. And I want to, beloved, who says this? Jesus. I will build my church. That is wonderful, liberating. My church, my camp, my mission field, my project. It's Jesus. We get to play part. This is not my church. We are board-led, membership-driven. You vote on what we want to present. You vote the budget. You vote the people that are hired. You vote situations. You vote board-led, membership-driven. If you want to be a member, you should be a member. We need to bring you into membership. Peter's going to lead this group. He was doing that there. And then, beloved, I get a note there that says, oh, the gates of Hades will not be able to prevail against it. We've covered that. Verse 19 is an interesting one, quickly. And he says, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound on heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. We've talked about that. We won't spend time here much with it. But really, the power is given to the church as to what things. And if a church wants to say, everybody has to wear black. That's the church's power to say that. Why you're saying, you can't say the Spirit of God showed me in a vision and dream. You can say that God showed you in a vision and dream. I think that maybe it wasn't the Lord that told you that. But if the church says, we all here want to worship, people who worship different than us, you don't need to run them down. If they're telling the story of Jesus different than us, but the same, you got to know Jesus to be saved, but you can't eat in church or you can't ever wear a dress or pants or whatever, you girls. And if that's different, God bless them. Because Jesus says what? If you ain't against us, you're for us. Just by not being against us, you're for us. And so but fit in. But the keys of the kingdom of heaven, whatever you bind, you can put things down there and whatever, but be careful because Paul works this out about liberties in Christ. Whatever you loose shall be loosed in heaven. That's interesting language. We'll come back to visit that sometime. But verse 20, beloved, I think is a key part of this whole story, where the part where he talked about who he was. And he says, don't tell anybody who I am. And then he warned the disciples that they should not tell no one that he was the Christ. And he's meaning for right now. Because he's going to go to the cross. He's going to be raised from the dead. And then it's freedom for all. You tell the story of Jesus and his love. You tell the story how this man, and Paul says, why am I baptized for the dead if the dead can't rise? And that's a discussion in Corinthians he's talking about. And some people say, we have to be baptized for dead people so that they can get into heaven. That's not in the book. That's not in the book. Paul says, baptized for the dead, identify with a dead man. If he didn't rise from the dead, what am I identifying with him for? Warn the disciples, don't tell anybody who I am. Beloved, those are the important fortifications of our church. Get your head around that one. Jesus says that we say about Jesus, he's the Christ, the Son of the living God. And he says, I will build my church. I will build my church. And people build other churches. They're not much for Jesus' church. They're about wealth and fancy and pomp and ceremony and all those things. And where's Jesus fit in? Well, he's the guy that helps us bring the money and stuff like that. That's not Jesus' work. I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. No vision? Well, over here, if you have a vision, it's supposed to bring you to the Word of God and help you be in line with that. Our challenge is. And so we trust our hearts will be encouraged with that. We want to sing our closing hymn. And Pauline, we don't have your words. It's ancient words. Ancient words of our Bible, the Word of God. God's given these things that come down through history. And when you get to share with people and show them, you know what this says in the Bible? We shared this story a little bit last night where Abraham is asked the question, Dad, here's, what's that? I'm sorry. He said, it's not in your hymn book. If you look in your hymn book, he says, here's the wood, here's the fire, where's the lamb? I was able to share this story last night and to say this. The Hebrew reads there, God says, God will provide himself a lamb. God will provide himself a lamb. We see Jesus as the Lamb of God, God in the flesh, come down. Where's the wood? Here's the wood. Where's the fire? Where's the sheep? Well, it was caught in the bushes physically. But he says, God will provide himself a lamb. Ancient words. Got it there? Good. Let's stand together as we sing. Glenn, you'll dismiss us in prayer. Come on forward or spin your camera. How you do? When you would. Thank you.
Strength, help us, Lord.
I dismiss this prayer?
Our Heavenly Father, I pray that the words that we hear from your word would truly change us, and not only change our hearts, but change our community and those in our church, that we would see the power of the work of your spirit in us. And so we just thank you for that, that it's true and that it is powerful. Lord, we thank you for the fortifications of our church that we heard about this morning, and that Jesus, you will build the church how you want to see it, not how we want to see it. And I pray that when it's needed, that we would get out of the way of what you are doing in our church, Lord. We want to come along for the ride. We want it to be your will that is done. And we seek you with wisdom that comes from your spirit, Lord, as we make decisions, even in the coming weeks. So we just pray that you would guide and direct us in that. Go with us this week, we pray, and that your words would continue to change us this week, and we'd be drawn to you more and more. So bless us, we pray now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.